Benefit Streets is about to change.
The Universal Credit will restore fairness and simplicity to a complex, outdated, and wildly expensive benefits system.
The government is rolling out the biggest welfare shake-up for decades.
I thought it was a fantastic idea as well, because I am one of the people who does actively seek work.
They say it will slash costs, help you back to work, beat the cheats, and it's simple.
If that's simpler, I'd hate to see it when it's difficult.
It's designed to change Britain's benefits culture forever. Tonight on Dispatches, we investigate whether the new universal credit is really going to work. Meet the gardener, the mum, the sales assistant, and the unemployed security guard. These four really matter. They're at the sharp end of a £13 billion experiment. If it works for them, it could be good news for millions claiming benefits.
If I could have gone straight back into work, I would have gone straight back into work.
I don't want anybody to be looking down on me or pitying me.
All four live in Warrington, a relatively prosperous northern town. It's one of the first places to try out a brand new way of dealing with benefits. It's called Universal Credit. Six different benefits have been replaced by one. So, in theory, you no longer need to worry about losing money if you take part-time or low-paid work. Universal Credit should top up your wages automatically. By now, a million people are meant to be on this new benefit, but that plan has gone horribly wrong. In fact, just a few thousand have claimed it so far. To find out what's gone on, we've spent the summer following the government's Warrington guinea pigs to see how it's working on the ground. The promise was the new system would be easy to use.
I am delighted to announce the introduction of the fairness and simplicity to a complex, outdated...
But how simple is it?
At least it's a good day and you can get it.
Connor Helps has moderate learning difficulties. He turned 18 and for support was living with his foster family. Because he was in the pilot area, he was assessed for Universal Credit when he applied online.
Can we just get a door for you?
Please.
It didn't take into account Connor's position. We just ended up ticking boxes that was the closest to at least get the claim on.
Connor and his foster mum went along to the job centre to check they'd filled the form in correctly. They say the staff there seemed baffled.
Just nobody understood what we were trying to say. We had three people around
us.
And the outcome of it was, oh, well, just fill the claim in and we'll see what happens. That was their attitude.
Connor managed to pick up some shop work and was about to start a training course. He was told he wasn't eligible for Universal Credit, so he claimed another benefit, income support. But then he was wrongly told he wasn't entitled to that either, because, you guessed it, he still had an existing Universal Credit claim.
Seeing as it got us to the point of being in tears almost, if that's simpler, I'd hate to see it when it's difficult. Because between us, between us, the CAB,
social workers, everything, it didn't go well.
We just couldn't get it right between us all.
One thing seems straightforward, the strict conditions Connor was given to qualify for the new benefit.
I'll take on any work I'm able to do that pays £5.03 an hour. Is within 90-minute travel from my home. I will apply for vacancies I'm told to apply for by my advisor. I will normally spend 35 hours each week looking and preparing for work. If without good reason I don't do all these things, my universal credit payments will be cut by £8.20 a day for up to 3 years. I spent a lot of time with him, sat with him, looking at things and helping him to understand what was in front of him, because he didn't always get what you had to do, did you?
If I did it by myself, I wouldn't be able to cope because it's too stressful at the end of the day.
It's not just, it's the stress, but it's also the understanding, isn't it?
Yeah, I won't get it all, I won't get the questions, I won't know what they're asking me or anything.
After more than 3 weeks of to-ing and fro-ing, the claim was sorted and Connor was given income support, backdated to when he first applied. The Department for Work and Pensions unreservedly apologised for any distress and said their staff were confused about his entitlement.
I'd actually got to the point where Connor sat there as close as he is to me now and he said, kick me out.
It's easier.
You'll have to kick me out so I can get some money.
It's a lot easier.
Connor's case should have been relatively straightforward, and indeed most claims so far in the pilot are from young single people without kids or a mortgage.
It seems to me that, you know, if you can't iron out the problems with straightforward single claimants, and, you know, initially we're seeing that people whose circumstances change, the system doesn't appear to be able to cope seamlessly with that, with those changes. That if we rolled it out to people with disabilities, families with children, you know, all the vulnerable people, to my mind, it would just compound the problems.
And that's key, because Universal Credit is supposed to make the benefit system much simpler for everyone. Life changes, and Universal Credit is meant to be able to respond to that. So, if someone moves in with a partner, their payment should adjust with ease. Jay Montrose was living on his own in Warrington and claiming Universal Credit. Then, in June, he moved in with his partner, Nikki, and their son, Ethan. The job centre told the couple, who were expecting another baby, that they would be treated as joint Universal Credit claimants.
When I first started the claim for Universal Credit, I thought it was a fantastic idea as well, because I am one of the people who does actively seek work, and the fact that you have to do 35 hours job search a week, I thought that's fantastic. It's going to keep you active, make sure you get a job quickly.
But adjusting the couple's joint payment proved far from easy. Jay and Nikki kept getting passed from the job centre to the service centre that actually processes the claim. Neither would authorise payment.
Everybody turned around to me from the service centre and the job centre and said that it was very complex and that the training hadn't been there for them to know what they had to do.
They turned around and said, well, it's all new, the systems are all changing, we've got to get used to it, and went, yeah, but how's that our fault? How come we've been penalised in this way? Because you don't know what you're doing. Surely you should have all have had your training before you even set up this Universal Credit. You should have been 100% knowing what you're doing.
Not knowing meant in practice that the two adults and their child had to get by on a single person's payment. They soon began to struggle, even for food.
So when it comes to Ethan, we always made sure there was something in for him. He's not gone hungry.
I was worried purely just because I'm pregnant at the moment and I should be eating at least enough to get me through. I shouldn't be living off a packet of crisps in a day because that was all that was in that could be spared that Ethan didn't need. The only thing really that we both had was coffee.
Yeah.
Because it does make you sort of not want to eat.
Yeah.
You don't feel as hungry.
The family say that as the weeks went by, their debts built up. In total, they owed £2,500, and their landlord warned them they might face eviction.
It was heartbreaking to think, I'm going to ring these people up, try and find out what's going on, and they're just going to be like, well, we're just sorting it out. It's like, no, we need to know what's happening now. We just had a letter through our door. We've had a phone call saying they're going to seek possession of our property. We will be homeless. Me, my partner and my child will be homeless. And you don't know what's going on.
The Department for Work and Pensions dispute that their staff weren't clear about what information was needed. They say the claim was delayed because Nikki and Jay failed to complete the correct forms. The couple say they only received the correct money after staff told them their claim was being processed by hand.
It's not specifically the job centre staff's fault. It's whoever's come up with this idea and not done the specific training. It's not fair on them, but it's not fair on the people that are on the benefits as well.
When it was first announced, Universal Credit was met with strong cross-party support and backing from some of the big welfare rights groups. but bit by painful bit, this flagship project has lost its shine.
Shocking failures, alarmingly weak management, and the waste of £140 million of public money.
The reform was beset by rollout delays.
The government's been left trying to defend its flagship welfare reforms, universal credit, after a scathing report by the spending watchdog. The National Audit Office said the changes were overambitious and poor value for money.
And then the £13 billion project faced the singular humiliation of being sent back to the drawing board by a government watchdog. The government insists universal credit is working well on the ground in places like Warrington.
Liz McKean.
Hi, Liz. Nice to see you.
Thank you very much.
And is improving as they test the system out.
You talk about test and learn. The reality is you're doing it on people. There is a human cost to the learning process. Do you accept that?
When you're rolling out a new benefit or doing any change, there's two ways of doing it. You either effectively do a big bang approach where you roll it out across the whole country in one go. What we've deliberately done is done it in a careful way across in small areas so that we can learn from the things that don't go well at the beginning, improve the system as we roll it out to make sure that experience for universal credit claimants is a good one.
A good experience is not how some of those claiming in Warrington may choose to describe the new system.
Under the old system, most social housing tenants had their rent paid directly to their landlord. But to make it more like the private sector, under universal credit, the rent is paid to the tenant. It's designed to reflect the world of work and to make claimants more financially responsible, in theory.
Sean Pierce worked as a security guard for 5 years, but in March he was made redundant. As this was his first experience of universal credit, he says he asked for a breakdown of exactly what the benefit was meant to cover, and that this never came.
Waiting for 3 months with nothing.
His benefits arrived, but Sean says he didn't understand the universal credit payment, nor that it included the money he'd need to pay for his rent. By the time he was told, Sean had run up rent arrears of £800.
Someone had to pay the rent. Who did you think was going to do it?
Well, exactly, yeah.
I should have been a bit more clued up. I should have found out what it was all about. But I've been in work for the best part of 5 years, so I just assumed that, right, the rent was being paid for, everything was fine.
Sean found some temporary work, but by September was unemployed again and struggling to pay off his debt. He thinks the simplest solution will be to give up his flat.
I'll have to go to somewhere else and start again and clear this debt, because universal credit has, with the rent arrears, caused a lot of damage, and I just can't afford to live anymore, so.
According to the DWP, the claim form, leaflets in job centres and their website clearly state which benefits are covered by universal credit. They say they issued a letter to Sean in June detailing the breakdown of his payments. Sean insists he didn't receive such a letter. Sean's mistake left him in hot water, and we've discovered that he's by no means the only one.
If there's any reason why a claimant might struggle with budgeting, for instance, a history of financial or other problems, then they're supposed to be identified and given extra help. In those cases, the rent might be paid directly to the landlord. But Warrington's largest social landlord tells us that help isn't always being given, and some vulnerable tenants are falling into debt.
I think we're only aware of one or two tenants who've been offered personal budgeting support at that initial stage. So I think a lot more work needs to be done to make sure people who are vulnerable get the level of help that they need to make success of universal credit, because I'm sure nobody wants that to fail.
Are the most vulnerable claimants failing to get help? The DWP hasn't published any figures on universal credit rent arrears since the new benefit was introduced. So we surveyed seven major landlords renting homes to a total of 158 tenants claiming the new benefit across the UK. Nationally, 5 out of 10 people in social housing are in arrears. But amongst tenants we surveyed on Universal Credit, that figure jumps to just under 9 out of 10. Almost a third are facing court proceedings for eviction. And since they first signed on, more than a third have had to have their rent paid direct to the landlord. Many of the landlords tell us that Universal Credit might increase their rent arrears and workloads, and that would compromise the services they offer other tenants. They also warn the new benefit could make more people homeless.
From the research you've done and from what the social landlords have said, it would appear that there are large numbers of people getting into arrears, and that would obviously be really, really worrying, because if they start off in arrears, then it's very difficult for them to recover.
Our survey showed that 9 out of 10 Universal Credit claimants were in rent arrears, so that shows that they're not budgeting in the way that you say.
Well,
Nine out of ten.
Well, I think the first thing to remember is, if you look at the evidence, quite a lot of people who are in social housing have rent arrears in the first place. And what our pilot showed was that initially when people moved on to Universal Credit, there was sometimes a period where it took a little while for them to get used to budgeting monthly and paying those bills, but after a month or two, it's stabilised.
The government also says that work coaches now discuss arrears and budgeting support with all claimants at their very first work search interview. If you're claiming Universal Credit and identified as vulnerable, your rent may be paid directly to your landlord. But that doesn't mean things necessarily run smoothly. Warrington's biggest landlord says it's received payments late, with no name attached or for incorrect amounts. It says although that's improved recently, it is still owed money.
How efficient are the DWP about payments?
It requires manual intervention by staff to send the money to us rather than to the tenant. And unfortunately, there have been cases in the past where instead of sending the money to us, which has been agreed, it's still gone to the tenant and arrears have grown.
It sounds like there have been a lot of administrative mistakes.
We've certainly identified a number of payments where we felt that the amount was wrong. It has meant that we have to spend quite a bit of time almost redoing the sums that the DWP have done to make sure we get the right amount of housing costs paid to ourselves.
Just why are so many people complaining so much about how the new system is working? Well, an insider based at one of the centres processing Universal Credit agreed to talk to us as long as their identity was concealed.
The training for staff running Universal Credit isn't relevant anymore. It doesn't reflect the recent changes to the Universal Credit system. Trainers point that out to the DWP, but nothing's done about it.
The whistleblower described the IT system as completely unworkable, badly designed, out of date, and says it lets them down.
The IT works for single claimants, the straightforward cases. More complex claims have to be done manually. That's slow and it's easy to get it wrong.
Our source is telling us that staff at the Universal Credit call centres are sometimes dealing with just 3 tasks a day. Tasks are parts of the claim. We're told they're supposed to be handling nearly 10 times that number.
The Department for Work and Pensions says
there is no evidence that more complex cases cannot be dealt with successfully.
And there are
no targets for the number of claims staff should process each day.
They say our information is outdated and they now have better contact with landlords like Golden Gates, and they've stepped up support for them.
All payments to landlords are accurate and up to date.
And they also say new safeguards mean rent arrears are tackled more quickly.
If there's 1 month of arrears, there's a review of the case so that it can be decided to pay the landlord direct. And if someone builds up 2 months of arrears, then it switches straight to paying the landlord direct.
After the break, we reveal a telling email from inside the Universal Credit Office.
Ideas, please.
sinking. Dispatches is in Warrington to investigate the government's big idea for welfare reform, universal credit. It's the benefit that could soon be coming to a street near you. One of its central aims is to simplify the system for claimants.
No longer will they be able to say that they are trapped in a complex system, which means that they have to go to seek an advisor.
But the new system proved too complex for gardener Jeff Packer.
Every November I have to sign on because it's no work because of the seasonal side. You apply for jobs, very rarely you hear anything back. I tend to go around firms giving out the CVs. At least they know who you are and if you know like where you've been working.
Today, Jeff's in court because he has council tax arrears.
Summons today to go to court and set up an arrangement to pay it off. I need to go and see my money advisor to sort things out.
Since April 2013, most claimants have had, for the first time, to pay a proportion of their council tax bill themselves. Some are entitled to help with their council tax, but to get it, they must make a separate claim. Surprisingly, the so-called universal credit doesn't include your council tax benefit.
Certainly, we're seeing people who are in receipt of their universal credit and they suddenly notice their council tax benefit is not being paid or the local council support scheme is not being paid, probably because it hasn't been claimed. But are they being advised clearly at the point of claim, you are also eligible for local council tax support and this is how you claim it?
Jeff says he just didn't understand the system, nor that he was running up council tax debts.
Council tax, if it was all consolidated like it was on the old system, everybody got paid, but now it makes everything more complicated because you don't know how much money you've got left. This new system, you know, like, be a lot of debt.
The DWP say Jeff was sent a letter providing a full breakdown of his payment and that his Job Centre Plus work coach made it clear that council tax support was not included. According to our Universal Credit Insider, it's not just claimants, but some staff as well who are struggling to get to grips with the system and the workload.
Claimants are confused and so are staff, but they have to stick to the script they're given when they're trying to sort problems out. The workload for staff is 10 times more complicated than it was, so there are hundreds of tasks outstanding.
It isn't just our whistleblower who thinks there's a problem with universal credit. We've seen this internal memo. It comes from a manager at one of the service centres who heads up a team of sanctions decision makers. And it seems that all is not well behind the scenes. She's emailed her team, ideas please, sinking.
We've been given this email. It's pretty straightforward. It's from a manager in one of the service centres who heads up a team of people, and it's called Ideas Please Sinking. And she's basically saying the workload is too great. Mm. They cannot cope.
Well, all I can say is I've been to one of our centres that does this, and I've spoken to some of the frontline staff. I've listened to the calls that they've done with customers, and I was actually quite pleasantly surprised that I had nothing but positive feedback. I went to talk to staff, you know, who weren't necessarily expecting me to come and talk to them, and I had a very positive experience, and they're very committed to dealing with making this work for our claimants.
So you don't recognise the idea that she's overburdened with the caseload, appealing to staff for help?
No,
you don't recognise that?
No, I don't recognise that at all, no.
She says she has to clear 402 cases and only thinks she'll clear 130.
No, I don't recognise that at all. One of the things we've done about rolling this out sensibly is we've resourced it as we've gone along. This is our top priority in the department in terms of it's the single biggest welfare reform, I think, for a generation.
Now Ian Duncan-Smith has announced he will accelerate the scheme's rollout. By the end of our summer in Warrington, nationally 16,500 people had started on universal credit. From February next year, it will be extended to all job centres in Great Britain.
Another 7 million plus to go.
We've been promised by the Secretary of State that Universal Credit will be on time, on budget. Can you see that happening?
I can't see it either being on time or on budget. And I think rather than taking one area of welfare and reforming it and doing it well, they've tried to do too much too quickly. And as a result, the big flagship policy of universal credit appears to me to be unravelling at the moment.
We're not rolling it out too quickly. We're doing it gradually. We've done it in parts of the country first. We're rolling it out across the country for single people from February in a careful, thoughtful way. And I think the resources we've been putting into it are what we need to do that successfully. But the whole point of universal credit is to make sure we can say to somebody who's out of work, if you take a job, you will definitely be better off. And if you've got someone in work but perhaps not working as many hours as they want, if you take more hours, you will be better off. And I think we need to be able to say that to people. That's what universal credit will deliver.
So what has happened to our Warrington guinea pigs? Connor has now moved out of home. Nikki and Jay are paying off their debts. Jeff, the gardener, has cleared his council tax arrears. And good news for Sean, he's landed a temporary job and will stay in his flat. In the past 5 months, we've found that mistakes are still being made. For some, universal credit is too complex to navigate, and it seems some staff are struggling to cope. The government say the pilot is about testing and learning. The question remains, if they can't get it right in Warrington, how will the system cope when millions of us start claiming?